Oh, it's just too small.
Happy Super Bowl Sunday!
This morning, we want to welcome you who are here in the sanctuary and you who are watching at home or somewhere else this morning. We're glad that you are here with us today as well for our worship service. Our scriptures today come from 1 Corinthians and also from the first chapter of the Gospel of Mark. And we're going to be hearing a little bit about what it was that Jesus really came to do, and how that affects what we are supposed to do here. And my message this morning is entitled, I Don't Want to Be a Hero, which was seemed to be the way that Jesus was leading his life at the time of the story in today's gospel. We're going to hear some wonderful special music this morning, right up there with Dropkick Me Jesus. And we're going to celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion this morning. And I'm going to invite you now to join with me in our responsive call to worship that you will see on the screen. And we're going to pray these screens work. We've made some minor adjustments, but we think we have found the problem. And we have parts and root that are going to help us fix it permanently, thanks be to God. But we're going to try it this morning. If they flicker off, we're just going to keep going this morning. It's okay. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
The Lord is the everlasting God. Our God is the creator of the ends of the earth. The Lord gives power to the faint and strengthens those who are weak. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. Blessed be the name of God, day by day. Will you join your heart with mine in the time of prayer? O God, through Jesus, you opened the eyes of the blind, you healed the sick, and you fed the hungry. Father, by the Spirit, you restore strength to the weary, and you give hope to all those who are in despair. You call us, Lord, to proclaim your deeds and your wonders to all people. You call us to worship and to serve you, that all you made may be made whole. You offer us a new life of righteousness. So make us worthy, O Lord, to receive all of your gifts. Descend on each of us like the night of a new day. Give light to our souls and put your praise on our lips. Amen. I want to invite you to listen and to come along now as Lisa sings our opening songs.
Thank you. the football theme. I guess that was the anthem. And sometime here, I suppose we should also say the halftime show today is going to be a Jack's meditation followed by some special music. So don't go anywhere. Now the opening scriptures, we're going to start with Corinthians, and I always find it's interesting to get a little context of these things. This is one of Paul's letters, and you know, he wrote letters to the Galatians, the Ephesians, the Philippians, the Colossians, the Thessalonians, any place that ended in a shun, I think, got a letter from Paul. But the people in Corinth, the church in Corinth, was an interesting one in terms of how they were, what their makeup was. And earlier in Corinthians, it kind of gave a description of that. That church was made up of converted idolaters, adulterers, prostitutes, thieves, drunkards, and swindlers. Quite the crew. So to say that they might have been a cynical audience would probably be complimentary. So in Paul's letter in Corinthians, I think what he was trying to do was establish some credibility, establish his authority, and to try and convince this audience that he wasn't in it just for his own personal glory. So 1 Corinthians 9:16 through 23. For when I preach the gospel, I cannot boast, since I am compelled to preach. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. If I preach voluntarily, I have a reward. If not voluntarily, I am simply discharging the trust committed to me. What then is my reward? Just this, that in preaching the gospel, I may offer it free of charge, and so not make full use of my rights as a preacher of the gospel. Though I am free and belong to no one, I have made myself a slave to everyone, to win as many as possible. To the Jews, I became like a Jew, to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so as to win those under the law. To those not having the law, I became like one not having the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so as to win those not having the law. To the weak, I became weak to win the weak. I have become all things to all people, so that by all means possible, I might save some. I do all this for the sake of the gospel, that I may share in its blessings. In other words, he wasn't there to be a hero. The second reading is from Mark 1, 29 through 39. As soon as they left the synagogue, they went with James and John to the home of Simon and Andrew. Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they immediately told Jesus about her. So he went to her, took her hand, and helped her up. The fever left her, and she began to wait on them. That evening after sunset, the people brought to Jesus all the sick and demon-possessed. The whole town gathered at the door, and Jesus healed many who had various diseases. He also drove out many demons, but he would not let the demons speak because they knew who he was. Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed. Simon and his companions went to look for him, and when they found him, they exclaimed, "Everyone is looking for you." Jesus replied, "Let us go somewhere else, to the nearby villages, so I can preach there also. This is why I have come." So he traveled throughout Galilee, preaching in their synagogues and driving out demons. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Well, friends, if you are like me and something less than perfect, I want to invite you to join your heart with mine in a time of prayer as we confess our sins before God. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the way of peace. Come into the brokenness of our lives and our land with your healing love. Help us to be willing to bow before you in true repentance and to bow to one another in real forgiveness. By the fire of your Holy Spirit, melt our hard hearts and consume the pride and the prejudice which separate us. Hear us now as we offer to you our silent prayers of confession. Fill us, O Lord, with your perfect love, which casts out our fear, and bind us together in that unity that you share with the Father and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, may Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us all of our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen us in our goodness by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us to eternal life. Amen. We have some wonderful special music for you this morning that Joey is going to offer us, and we want you to sit back and enjoy Joey's gifts this morning. Will you join your heart with mine in a word of prayer? God, we thank you for the talent that we have just enjoyed and the message to be still. Help each of us now to hear that message and to be still as you speak to us. I pray through my words and through the meditations of all of our hearts. We pray this today in Jesus' name. Amen. So the words that you heard Gary read just a couple of seconds ago said, in the morning when it was still dark, Jesus got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everybody's searching for you." And he answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also. For that is what I came to do." So I remember this old joke I heard. It seems that there was an elderly man who was quite ill, and one day he turned to his wife and he said, "You know, Sarah, you have always been with me in the good and the bad. Like the time I lost my job, and you were right there by my side. And when the war came, and I enlisted, you became a nurse so that you could be with me. And then when I was wounded, you were there, Sarah, right by my side. And then the depression hit, and we had nothing, but you were there with me. And now here I am, sick as a dog, and as always, you are right beside me. You know something, Sarah? You're bad luck." There is a part of us, I think, that is tempted to look for anybody we can to blame all of the things that go wrong in our lives, all the things that don't happen as we had hoped they would. And more often than not, the people that we choose to blame are the very people we once looked to for the answers to all of our questions. There's little doubt in today's gospel reading is an attempt by the writer of Mark to create a sort of composite day in the life of Jesus. Jesus is pictured as a very busy man with a seemingly never-ending stream of people coming to him with problems they needed solved and afflictions they needed cured. He's at the peak of his public popularity in the Galilean ministry. The entire countryside is at his feet. He could have asked for anything, and you get the feeling the people would have obliged. If he had proclaimed right then a holy war against the Romans, why, people would have taken up their arms and started marching. If he had proclaimed himself as the Messiah, the new King of Israel, why, the triumphant procession to Jerusalem would have begun right then and there. In other words, Jesus had the people right where any political leader would want them, in the palm of his hand. But what does Jesus do in response to that marvelous opportunity? Well, he sneaks off early in the morning before anybody else is awake so that he can be by himself. And then when his friends and disciples literally have to track him down in order to inform him that people are hanging on his every word, what does he choose to do in his response? Well, he says, "Let's go somewhere else so that I can do what I came to do." What is it that Mark wants us to see, I wonder, about this characteristic behavior of Jesus? You know, it's kind of hard to be certain. G.K. Chesterton, an author, once bemused that Jesus went off by himself just in order to get a good laugh. You see, in other words, he couldn't stand the kind of ridiculous expectations that his friends and his followers were making of him, and so he had to go off just to laugh to keep his sanity. Maybe. Certainly everybody seems to want a piece of him in this picture that Mark has painted for us. Maybe he went off by himself just to get some quiet and peace for a change. Who knows? But one thing is certain. Instead of cultivating the enormous popularity that his words and his deeds had won him, Jesus seemed instead to be really uninterested in the kind of success that people wanted to shower upon him. You see, he was just not content to be the kind of hero that eventually might make it to a state capitol or to the White House. He wouldn't listen to the instructions of his handlers when they wanted to give them to him. He simply didn't have the goal of making a big name for himself. And when he did get a big name, without trying to get one, he had absolutely no desire to cash in on it. It's hard not to hazard the guess that Jesus might have been just a little suspicious of such popularity. Even if he didn't have a sneak preview of what was in store for him, you didn't have to have a doctorate in psychology to figure out that this brief moment of popularity is going to come to an end. At least the gospel writers all seem to assure us that, and to assume that Jesus knew this was going to happen. The cheering crowds would eventually become an angry mob. The star-struck disciples who followed him everywhere in the end would become totally frustrated and disillusioned, and Jesus would fall from being the golden-haired hometown kid who was going to make everything right for everybody to being a national disgrace and a public embarrassment. He would not turn out to be the kind of Messiah, leader, and hero people hoped that he would be. And so knowing that, he goes off to think. Now I have a friend of mine who I have known for a long time, and he and I were having lunch together one day, not that awful long ago, and we were trying to figure out why it is that some congregations keep shooting themselves in the foot whenever a new pastor comes to town. My friend is retired from ministry, and he is glad to be retired from ministry, he tells me, after some 40 years. He has served in the parish, he has served as a chaplain in hospitals and correctional institutes, and worst of all, at least according to him, he at one time was a teacher in a Bible college. And he said these words to me, "The scenario never seems to change. The Pastoral Relations Committee, which we know in our vernacular as the SPRC, goes to great lengths to categorize the ideal candidate for the minister's job. Somebody creative, somebody progressive, who will lead us intelligently and bravely into the new millennium." Then when the candidate arrives, brimming over with high ideals and boundless enthusiasm, it is usually just a matter of months before somebody puts the brakes on things and lets the new minister know that she or he is not going to change anything here. Why is it, my friend asks, what is it that makes congregations keep pursuing this suicidal madness? Maybe just this. The reason that people became disenchanted, I think, with Jesus in the end is precisely because he wasn't interested in saving the whole world, the free world. He wasn't interested in organizing an evangelical campaign or founding a new religion. All Jesus wanted to do was to preach the good news. And the good news is, of course, that we people are required to change ourselves before we can try to change the world or other people. And after a while, that good news began to sound like bad news to a whole lot of people. Because isn't it easier to just get rid of the Romans, or in today's vernacular, the conservatives or the liberals or the Republicans or the Democrats or the socialists or the fascists? Starting a new church, punishing evildoers, denouncing people who don't live up to our particular moral standards or beliefs, well, that's something we can all sink our teeth into. We like goals that are clearly identifiable. But you know, this whole idea of transforming our own lives, because the good news says that God loves us all and has now set us free to be the very best that we can be, well, that sounds just a little bit scary. Because God, if God has already forgiven us, and there's really nothing standing in our way from becoming the people we know we can be, then the good news is obviously going to mean that we have to work. We have to risk. There's personal sacrifice. We have to dissolve old habits. We have to acquire new ones. In that light, going after other people and getting rid of them is a much more preferable option. For it is much easier to accuse others of being fake and living a life of hypocrisy than it is to look in the mirror at our own nastiness and defensiveness and insincerity. Anybody who insists on preaching a vision that God's love insists that we change ourselves as well as the social and religious and cultural order around us had better check over his or her shoulder once in a while. Because it seems, at least for a good part of the time, that we are all quite willing to believe the good news. If we believe that it demands that other people's lives change, and we are quite unwilling to accept the good news that demands our lives to change. Unfortunately for Jesus, and unfortunately for the complacency for which we often settle, the good news is that we can overcome the restlessness so that we can make it through our days. We can be gifted with the hope that this day's reality does not have to be the last word. And we can rediscover the joy of living by finding new ways of loving others. But the good news can only be ours, friends, if we abandon our quest for security and give up that rigid defensiveness that we often have to keep others at bay. You see, the kingdom of God becomes a reality within us when we realize that peace and joy and contentment are found in living trustful, open, gracious lives no matter what happens. That's not an easy game to play. And whoever preaches a message like that probably isn't going to be popular in their town for very long. Because we naturally prefer heroes who'll do it all for us, rather than invest in changing ourselves to change the world first. We're going to move into a time of prayer this morning, and as we do, Lisa's going to offer us a prayer song that's going to get us into an attitude of prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Oh God, we thank you that we are not alone, that you are here with us. Help us today to proclaim your presence in our lives and in the world to all around us. Help us all to know and to recall the difference walking with you really makes, to share that with others out of the very depths of our own being, so that they may too know where hope and help is to be found, so that they may know where to find the food that we have found. Bless, O God, your church, and bless this congregation of your people, that we might be light to enlighten the darkness, salt to savor and preserve the world, yeast to raise up the loaf, and seed for the fertile ground. Make each of us ministers of your grace in both word and deed. Give grace, O Father, to all who, like Simon Peter's mother, suffer the infirmities of the body this day. Especially we ask you to continue to be with Darlene and Jamie and Josh and Kay and Joyce and Becky and Mike. Be, O God, with all those who suffer because of the coronavirus, whether they suffer a body or mind or spirit. Lord, bring healing to your world. And Lord, we ask all of these things this day. We give all of our praise and all of our thanksgiving through Jesus Christ our Lord, our friend and our brother, and the one who taught us all to pray when we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Holy God, we thank you that you called us into existence by your word, for speaking your words of demand and grace through teachers and prophets, for promising that your words would be written on our hearts. We marvel with gratitude that your word became flesh and lived among us in Jesus, that he suffered as we suffer, to be with us and to die for us, that you raised him from the dead in victory over death and sin. Holding the glad word of your good news in our minds, may our spirit be transformed by this bread and cup into signs of Christ's living presence, and engrave upon our hearts that life-transforming image of Jesus. With all companions of Christ's, in every day and time and place, we praise your holy name. When they were seated at the table, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body." And then after supper, he took a cup. And after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." Jesus said, "I tell you, I will never again drink of the fruit of this vine until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." Oh God, we pray today that you would bless these loaves and cups, that you would bless all of us who receive them, so that we might be strengthened by this meal to to go forward and change the world. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Gary and I will bring you the communion elements this morning in the small plastic cups, and you will remember that there are two plastic seals on the top of the cup. The first one is a clear one and will allow you to have access to the wafer that is there that will represent for you today the body of Christ. And the second seal is the purple colored seal that will allow you to have access to the juice that is in the cup that represents for you today the blood of Christ. We will bring you the gifts and serve you in your seat. I'll invite you to receive communion whenever you are ready in your own seat. And then when you leave this morning, to take the empty container with you, and there'll be a trash can right outside the door as you leave this morning. So we will serve you now, the gifts of God for the people of God. God, we thank you for feeding us this morning here at your table. We thank you for looking past the lives that we have led, the mistakes that we have made, and the times we have disappointed your heart. And we thank you instead for seeing our hearts, hearts that earnestly desire to be closer to you. And so we do pray that through this meal we would be strengthened. We would go forth to spread the good news of Jesus Christ to the world. Amen. All right, there's some announcements this morning in the life of our church. In 3 days, the deadline will arrive for our snowman building contest. And you might have seen it on Facebook, you might have heard, read it in the family news or seen it in an email. We are having a contest to see who builds the best snowman. And all you need to do is build it and then take some pictures of it with your phone and email them to Ashley, or you can put it right on our Facebook page, attach them there. And the winner is going to get a free driveway shoveling by Ashley the next time it snows. Isn't that a wonderful gift? Ashley's ready. She's got her shovel is sharpened and she's ready to go. She's probably praying for spring to come tomorrow. But anyway, if you send us a picture of a snowman that you have built, we will be glad to include it on our Facebook page. The winner will get a driveway shovel, just a way that we can stay in touch with each other a little bit more. We want to thank you, as we do each week, for all of the gifts that you have given that allow us to continue to do the ministry that we do here in our community and indeed throughout the world. And if you are watching at home today, hopefully you know that there is a donate button that's on our church website where you can just click and make a donation to support the ministry and the work here at Emmanuel. We want to thank you for those gifts. And if you're watching at home today, a couple of requests. If you're watching on Facebook, will you like our page and perhaps share it? Because sharing really is caring. And also, maybe you'll just want to shoot us back a one-word comment. You know, glad to see you, glad you were here. Just so we can have a chance to interact directly with you on Facebook. If you're watching on YouTube, you're going to want to make sure that you click the subscribe button on the screen, and next to it there's a little bell. Click on that, and then click all entries, and the next time we upload something to YouTube, you'll get a little reminder that we have done that. So if you're at home and watching us today, we're glad you're there, and if you would do that for us, we sure would appreciate it. Next Sunday, we're going to celebrate the Transfiguration Sunday, and it's also, for you gentlemen, this is your early warning, it is Valentine's Day. Don't blow this, guys. This is a week's notice from your pastor. You can thank me later. Next Sunday, we're going to celebrate Valentine's Day as well as Transfiguration Day here in worship. All right, we're going to have Lisa sing our closing song for us this morning, and then I'm going to offer you some words of benediction. Have a great week, friends.